Welcome to a special edition of The Inside Voice. Composers and clinicians John Jacobson, Cristi Miller, Rollo Dilworth, and Roger Emerson discuss the joys and challenges of music education, focusing on teacher-student relationships, repertoire, the value of reading sessions, and more.
What do you think are some of the biggest challenges that are facing music educators today?
A fragmented society. We are the antidote to 24/7 news. All we're hearing is what's bad about our country and about the world. And I think that we have a rare opportunity in our classrooms to create the weather and to create good weather.
It does seem like our leadership, both in, you know, just in general and specifically in education, gives a lot of lip service to the support of the arts. You know, everybody says the arts are important, that it's a big, but our country gives a very small percentage of money and attention to the arts compared to other civilized countries. Mm-hmm. And I think we as teachers and educators and artists have to be the ones constantly pounding the table and making sure that that lip service is followed through with real support. Mm-hmm. I think that's a huge challenge for all of us who assume any kind of leadership position in music education.
Funding and advocacy. I think that there are very few music programs out there that the teachers would actually say, we have more than what we need financially in order to make our programs work. But also on the advocacy side, I think that music teachers have to spend so much of their energy not only helping these students to be the best who, you know, that they can be artistically, but trying to validate and demonstrate the worthiness of their programs when it should just be a given. As John said, we don't, I think, support the arts enough in terms of their value and how they contribute to the fabric of our society. And many, many cultures across this world that maybe aren't as developed in some ways as we are here in the United States, there is no need to validate the music or our art because it is such a part of the way of life of people that no one questions, why are you doing this, or why should we pay attention to this, or why should we support this? And I think that that's a challenge that we've been facing for way too long in a country that is as advanced as ours in so many other ways.
You know, I'm going to speak from a smaller scale. I see and hear so much from teachers that have so many other obligations outside of teaching. They have to implement so many programs within their class day, and yet they only see their kids once a week for 30 minutes, and yet they're required to do the reading program or this program or that program, or let's make sure that we get these benchmark things done. There's so many demands on teachers outside of music education that it makes them, their brains start, you know, frying because they can't figure out how to get it all worked in. And then you want me to do what? And then you need my lesson plans. That, I think, is a big challenge. And it's just because of this administrator need to, you know, we're going to make our kids the best. And so every year they change their philosophy and the teachers have to relearn. And then the music teacher kind of has to do it all in addition to already what they're.
Well, and that inability to make music just for the sake of making music.
Oh.
What's happened to that? And, you know, that is critical as far as I'm concerned. And, boy, I'll tell you, as a music educator, you have to put on your armor, and you have to advocate, and you need to get your parent group going. Because, you know, if 12 parents come together and support you, school boards will listen, superintendents will listen, principals will listen. Work that small community. It's very critical. I mean, yeah, it's essential.
Hesitate to ask, and this will probably get cut and probably should be cut from there. Hesitate to say that sometimes we're looked at as the whiners. You know, because we have to, we've been put in that position of having to advocate so much.
You know, it's interesting, though. I have several brothers who are school administrators, as was my father. And they always say to me that the music teacher is in their schools, and this has been their experience, so it's, you know, it's small, but it's a narrow experience, but they've been around. The music teacher seems to be always the one who's the most hesitant for the big ask, the one to come and really ask for stuff from the administrators. Mm-hmm. And they always find other teachers are more bold about it. And so the music teacher would say, well, I need the drumsticks. Maybe I can get one this year and one next year so we can actually play a drum instead of saying, I need 24 and I need it now. Right. I have a friend who's a music educator in California who, you know, gives a list at the beginning of the school year and sends it home to the parents and says, this is what we're going to do in the music program this year. It's going to be fabulous. All this, 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 this. Here's a list of 20 more things I'd love to be able to do. We need support for this, this, this. Some of it's financial. Some of it's I need 14 oboe reeds, and they cost this much. Who can come up with that? Some of them it's I want to do a musical that's going to cost $140. Somebody can come up with that. And parents look at that, and they kind of go, oh, you know what? I don't mind paying for something that's specific like that. I'll give you $100, and you can do this little kid's musical. Mm-hmm. That, and then in your program, you say, Johnny's parents sponsored this program. That kind of practical thing, music teachers have been
reluctant.
Mainly because they're overwhelmed.
Well, they've been reluctant and have felt for the longest time marginalized.
Right.
Because it's one of those things that's easily done away with.
Yeah, it's a tag on.
It's a tag on.
So, you know.
But we know better.